Hello and welcome. This is, I believe, the third episode in our professor podcast where students talk to teachers or professors about a topic of their interest that maybe has the possibility to go a bit beyond the bounds of the everyday academic work. Today we have mm-hmm. Professor Jingjing Li joining us. I'm very excited about that. And we're going to talk a bit about body image, representation or recognition, and particularly in the example of Asian Americans today. And yeah, we wanted to look at some pop culture examples, such as the wonderful movie Crazy Rich Asians or the great, great Netflix show Bling Empire. My name is Sophia. And I have with me Cecile.
Hello.
And yeah, let's kick this off. Do you want to say something at first to introduce yourself, Cecile, maybe?
Sure. Yeah, I'm Cecile. I'm a pre-master student and I did the Bachelor in Arts and Culture, where we also discussed a lot about popular culture and how this reflects society. So I'm very excited to talk about this today and I'm happy to be invited.
Yes. And I'm Sophia. I'm a second year bachelor student, and I'm currently also, or was taking today, or yesterday it ended, a course with Professor Li, and It was very, very nice. And so, yeah, welcome, Professor Li. Hi.
Thank you. Hi. Thank you for inviting me to be part of the show.
The show, yeah.
The show, because it's a podcast, right? And it will also be on YouTube, so it's a show.
It is a show. We will try exactly. to do our best to make it as show-like as possible. But yeah, also thank you very much for proposing this topic. And you sent us some articles before. I think we're going to link them for sure. And yeah, maybe we can kick this off by asking what particularly these days makes you think of these kind of things and what brought you to suggest this topic?
Yeah, I think it's recently, right? Because of the lockdown, most of us, we kind of stay at home a lot. So I am on Netflix and I am a big fan of a lot of Netflix TV shows. So recently there has been this TV show, which is called Bling Empire, right? So mm-hmm. it is kind of like a big hit on Netflix because recently I heard from the news that this reality show has been renewed for season two. So, but then in the meantime, I think it's, I also noticed that there is this ongoing movement of rebranding Asian Americans. So it could be traced back, right, to the release of the movie Crazy Rich Asians. So actually, even back then, right, when Crazy Rich Asians was released, there was also this discussion among my friends regarding how to perceive this movie, right? So I think the movie was released, and for a lot of Asian Americans at that time, they actually considered Crazy Rich Asians as the Black Panther for the Asian American community. So basically, at that time, the movie was very much revered, right? Primarily because of for several reasons. First, at that point, I think Crazy Rich Asians was released around 2017, right? So at that point, there was a very long time in Hollywood that no movie was primarily about Asian Americans until right. Crazy Rich Asians. That's the first reason. And the second reason was because in this movie, right, Asian Americans was represented differently. So before Crazy Rich Asians, another major hit was The Joy Luck Club. But that was actually, that movie was almost 20 years ago before Crazy Rich Asians. And then in that movie, Asian Americans, especially Asian American women, were depicted as being oppressed, as victims of a patriarchal Asian culture, and which was in sharp contrast to with Asian American women who were living in the United States at that time, right? So mm-hmm. that was the representation of Asian women 20 years ago in the movie The Joy Luck Club. However, we see a very different representation of Asian women in Crazy Rich Asians, right? So mm-hmm. for instance, the protagonist, right? She was a professor, she was financially sufficient and she had her own idea, right? She was full of agency. So that was the second reason why a lot of Asian Americans were very happy and excited about this movie. But after this movie was released, and then there were also a lot of questions among among Asian Americans. So basically, all of those questions, they revolved around this major point. Is this the kind of representation we want? Right. So basically, Asian Americans in the movie Crazy Rich Asians, as the name suggests, right, are being represented as not just rich, but crazily rich, right? As if there is this kind of secret image of Asian Americans only being discovered recently, right? Yeah. And then after the movie, there have been actually a number of reality shows. I think there is one, it's called The Whole Family. I think that was produced by HBO. So basically in that reality show, the protagonist, they were an Asian family based in US. And then more recently, right, we have another reality show, which is called Bling Empire. And as the name suggests, right, like a bling.
Very extreme.
Right. Yeah. it's similarly like Crazy Rich Asians, a very, like, both of the names have like a very strong brand.
Yeah. But also the emphasis on the craziness of it, right? I find that interesting why there is an emphasis on that they're crazy. Maybe it's in contrast to the previous stereotype that you see from like Asian people or American Asian people in the movie that you talked about earlier.
Yeah, actually this new reality show, right, Bling Empire, I think the first episode actually starts with this kind of description given by the protagonist in it, right? So I think one of the protagonists, Kevin, I think the opening remark he gave was something like, when I watched the movie Crazy Rich Asians, I thought it was just a fantasy until I moved to Los Angeles and meet Ken, right? And then afterwards, as you mentioned, right, So this kind of, those two things, right? Being super rich and then being crazy, right? So I think that those two factors, right? They can easily attract a lot of audience, right? So like it's a reality show for sure, but drama is at the center of the reality show, right? So like being super rich, that's very eye-catching. And then being crazy to one another, that's also very eye-catching, right?
Yeah, I looked this up before the podcast because I just wanted to know how much money, especially Crazy Rich Asians made, and it was $239 million. So and when it comes about rebranding, there is actually a lot of money involved in the production of, or not as much in the production, but there's in the way that this is being laid out, in the way that it's being branded, it is aimed at making a lot of money. And that's an important component as well.
Yeah, so commercially, right, it's very successful. I think that also explains why there are several TV reality shows, right, that kind of follow the same theme. But in the meantime, I think what I also noticed is that this rebranding, right, of Asian Americans at that point, back in 2016, it was a very general movement. So because of the Black Lives Matter movement, right, so there was actually a call for rebranding different communities in North America, like the Black community, the Asian community, right? And then it was definitely not the case if we went back in time several years ago that this kind of Crazy Rich Asian image became predominant. I kind of feel that it only becomes a little bit more visible and predominant recently, because if we go back in time, right, in 2016, there was also this movement of representing the everyday life of Asian Americans. So that's why there are also two very successful TV shows. One is Fresh Off the Boat, is produced in the US, and then Kim's Convenience that was produced in Canada. And unfortunately, Kim's Convenience, I think this entire TV show just ended. The recent season is the last season. I think it came to an end very recently. And then afterwards, we don't have any follow-ups. So I think this is an interesting question, right? So regarding rebranding Asian Americans. So at the very beginning of this movement of rebranding, there were several different trend, right? But eventually after 4 or 5 years, I think it becomes more and more evident which trend is more successful commercially. Mm.
Yeah, absolutely. And it also, I think a big thing or a figure in this rebranding that I think is very interesting is Ken Jeong. I don't know if you know him. He participated in Crazy Rich Asians, but he himself in the last, let's say, 20 years in Hollywood played this stereotype or body image of a very emasculated Asian man in different. So he, for example, I think the most noteworthy performance of his is in Hangover or in the Hangover franchise. And I don't, but he just plays the crazy, crazy guy. And there's a lot of references, for example, to his genitals. And so all of this. And then in Crazy Rich Asians, I think he's also, he was also a producer, but I'm not sure. And the whole advertisement of this movie was that there is also specifically a change in the male body image, and that what we need now is like hunky Asian men that run around shirtless and look really, really good. But of course, I think in our pre-talk, we talked also about what, when you change a body image, how do you do it in a way that does not create new standards that become unrealistic and similarly oppressive when it comes to things as facial structures or body body images as such.
Kim Jong is a very, very interesting figure. So I also watched The Hangover, all the movies in the trilogy, and for the first movie I was a little bit shocked by the portrayal of by the portrayal of the character, right, played by Kim Jong. And then afterwards I actually googled him, and then to my surprise he was very,
very
well
charming.
Very well educated. So before starting his career as an actor, he was actually a doctor. With a degree from a very prestigious university. And then I think after several years, I also watched one of his stand-up comedy shows.
It was very funny. I saw that one as well. Yeah.
Right, right. He ridiculed himself. He made fun of himself, right, of playing characters with that have been portrayed in a very from a very negative angle. Right. But I think this actually tells us a lot about this kind of image control, right? Because when we first look at it, we kind of perceive it from the lens of race and gender. But don't forget that we're also talking about Hollywood as a big business, right? So definitely capitalism is involved and money is involved, right? Mm-hmm. And then I think that also makes us think, why Asian Americans, right, for a long time have been represented in this manner, right? For sure, those representations in movies, they have their own targeted audience, right? So who are the targeted audience? As a matter of fact, for a long time, Asian Americans, they do not have a lot of control of their image, because they are not the dominant group in the society. And even this term Asian American, right, it was not coined by Asians themselves in North America. It was actually a term used by the lawmakers at that time when they wanted to put Asian Americans into a specific box so they can label it as a race. So it starts. So this is actually the very dark history of Asian Americans in the US, because at the very beginning, well, we all know, right, Canada and the US are immigrant societies, but at the very beginning, not all immigrants were welcomed. So immigrants from Europe, they were welcomed for sure, but immigrants from East Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, they were not treated equally. So basically, Asians started to arrive in North America quite early, I think in the second half of the 19th century. But at that time, most of them, they arrived, right, first and foremost on the West Coast. And a lot of them, they arrived in in North America because of this, because of the gold rush at that time. But then very quickly, they were being portrayed as some as people who are inferior, people who would work, right, regardless of the amount of payment. And then that is why shortly afterwards, because of this competition between different immigrant groups, right, who were all working class, and then Asians, because they were working very hard, and that created a lot of tension. And the Asians, they were considered as people who would take away jobs. And then that's why towards the end of the 19th century, there were actually a lot of exclusion acts imposed specifically on Asian Americans. But then what is interesting is at that time, Asian was not the term being used. The term being used was the Oriental. So basically, Filipino Americans, Chinese Americans, Japanese Americans, Korean Americans, Asian-born Indian Americans, they were called the Orientals, which could show that at that time, lawmakers, they actually didn't know how to brand them, right? And then it was, and then this Exclusion Act, guess what? It actually stayed until the 60s. So which means that before the 60s, if Asians, they wanted to come to North America, it was prohibited. And then for Asians who were living in North America, they had to pay head tax. And only Asian Americans, they should pay head tax, not other immigrants. And then during the 60s, after the civil rights movement, and then of course, right, Asian Americans, they forged the solidarity to fight back against a lot of discriminations. But then the first issue they encountered is, how do we identify ourselves? Who are we, right? And then they also realized that the term Orient, because of Edward Said's great work on Orientalism, right? Asian Americans also realized that they couldn't refer to themselves as the Orientals because of the negative nuance of this term. So that was the moment why they started to use Asian Americans as the term to identify themselves. But something tricky is that when we look at Asian Americans, it shows something that is that is as a group identity, right? But when we look closer, there are there are ethnic differences, there are cultural differences, there are religious differences, there are definitely gender differences. However, because of the spread, right, Asian Americans, something paradoxical happened. On the one hand, it helped Asian Americans to forge solidarity, but on the other hand, it also creates a lot of tensions because Asians ourselves, we do not actually agree with this label, right? There are a lot of internal differences in between. So ever since the 60s, this is the struggle for Asian Americans, especially in North America. And then on top of that, right, people start to think about the old term Oriental, right? The representation also goes the same way. So woman has been portrayed as hypersexual, especially in pornography. Asian women are particularly featured. I think after the very tragical incident in Atlanta, right? That is definitely a hate crime against Asian American women. And then in the statement from the criminal, right? So he basically said he did it because he wanted to stop his own because he was a sex addict, and he wanted to do this to cut off his own desire, right? And when you listen to it, you're kind of like, what is this, right? And then, but that's also for Asian men, right? Asian men has been portrayed as very feminine and less masculine, right? I think that, but then there is also this running theme that Asian Americans, they are lesser than regular human, right? Women are hypersexual and men, they are feminine, right? They are not masculine. So this has been how Asian Americans have been portrayed. Or you have the other trend, right? Like all Asians, they know martial arts, they do kung fu.
And how do you think how this relates to Bling Empire? Because there you also see that, for example, there is a very handsome male who is like also trying to be more sexual in that sense? Do you think they're actively trying to counter these controlling images? Or
for sure, I think that's definitely a resistance against the kind of portrayal of Asian American as being lesser, right? But then I think there is actually a step in between we haven't talked about, right? So it's not from the Joy Luck Club and then directly to Crazy Rich Asians, right? There is actually a middle step. The middle step has to do with this myth of Asians being model minority. Right. Yeah. So what is this meaning? So basically, the model minority image is already in an effort for Asian Americans to rebrand themselves. Right. But then this term model minority is also problematic because it shows that the image that has been implied here in this brand of model minority is that on the one hand, right, Asians acknowledge that they are minorities. So there is this message that Asians have already given up becoming the major group in society, right? But on the other hand, they are not any other minority, right? They are the model minority. So there is also this message that Asians, they are very loyal to the society, right? They're very hardworking. They're willing to assimilate themselves to the mainstream culture. So that's why they are the model minority in contrast to other minority, right? So that's why there has also been this ongoing discussion regarding whether this label of being a model minority, is it something Asians actually want or not?
What this model minority also still implies, of course, is that it's part of the gaze of a white society that tries to put people into places. So it is an image not created from themselves, but imposed, such as the hypersexualization. And I think that was in the Lori Kido Lopez article that we read, that was very interesting, where she also talks about how females are portrayed, especially to white audiences and to white male audiences, as a love interest. And she says it's in a way it's a taboo, or it tackles a taboo of interracial mixing, but without disrupting Western audiences. So it's very much caters to a comfort zone of white audiences. And I feel like the model minority also already has this inherent paradox of being a position of comfort, not for the Asian American community, but to the white community.
Right, exactly. That's why I think earlier we also mentioned that it's not only about race, gender, right? It's also about, because money is also involved if we think about this entire entertainment industry, right? Especially Hollywood is the main producer of those TV shows and movies, right? And for sure, I think that's why I also mentioned that whenever whenever they are making those movies, they definitely want to make money, right? So they need to know how to market those shows, and that is why they also need to know very well who are the targeted audience, right? And then I think that is why for a lot of TV shows, their targeted audience for a long time were never Asian Americans, right? Their targeted audience were members from the main social group, usually white people, right? So I think that's that kind of shows the underlying logic here, right? So I think in those articles, I think a recurring theme is really that this kind of body control, right, this image representation of Asian Americans, it is actually a phenomenon that stands at the intersection of a lot of issues, right? So it's not only about race, gender, it is also about the power structure in our society, but it is also not only about power structure, right? It is also about commercialization and capitalism, especially when we think about the entertainment industry, right?
Yeah, today the big franchises, they earn more and more money, and it's a talk of billions at this point. And there are different markets. It's also Hollywood, of course, caters not just to the US American market, it caters to Europe and also Asia at this point. So the big franchises also take that into account now, the audience broadens in many, many different aspects.
Right. So basically, when we look at the Crazy Rich Asians, right, I think something that has changed in this round of rebranding is Crazy Rich Asians and also Bling Empire, right? I think their targeted audience are not only white Americans, but also Asian Americans, right? Or even people, broadly speaking, right, who would be interested in seeing life of rich people and then enjoying the kind of drama, right? But then something interesting is that there are also many subtle differences between Crazy Rich Asians and Bling Empire, right? So in Crazy Rich Asians, we kind of see the counterattack against the image of Asians as being lesser, right? In the sense that they are the old image of Asians back in the back before the 60s was that Asians, they were uneducated, right? But they work hard and they didn't have any manners, right? So that was the image back in the 60s. And then in Crazy Rich Asians, we see a different image, right? So remember the beginning of that movie, right? So basically, Eleanor and her children and her friend, right? They went to, I think it's a hotel in London, right? Yeah, and then they were discriminated. Mm-hmm. And then somehow in the end, because she had money, right, she managed to turn the table and then humiliate the manager back, right? Yeah. So there are definitely a lot of counterattack, right, against this idea that Asians are uneducated, they are poor, right, they are not financially sufficient, right? Mm-hmm. But then the question is, I think maybe this has to do with the fact that I work on Buddhist philosophy, right? So in Buddhism, this kind of idea is that affirming something and rejecting something, how different is it? Because affirming something and rejecting something, even though at the surface level, they look very, they look like a polar opposite, right? But deep down, both attitudes, they never change the criteria being used for evaluation. Right. So eventually, Asian Americans are not lesser. Does it mean that Asian Americans, all of us, we need to be rich? Is that the message there? Mm-hmm. But aside from racial inequality, right? And then the gap between the rich and the poor, isn't that another type of inequality? Mm-hmm. So do we mean that Asians shouldn't be discriminated? But does it mean that people from underprivileged economic position, right, they should be discriminated? Mm-hmm. Or, I think those are the questions that remain unanswered, right?
Yeah.
But then in Bling Empire, there is something more, right? There are also a lot of backlashes against the model minority image in Bling Empire, right? Mm-hmm. Because if we think about this idea of Asians being the model minority, right? Model, what does that mean? Mm-hmm. They are hardworking, they are loyal to the country, they value education, right? They contribute to the society as much as they can. And then the other image, they don't make a fuss, right? They don't go out to protest against a different kind of
things. The opposite happens in the Bling Empire.
The sexual liberation also, this idea of I can do what I want. And I can be loud.
I am rich, so I remember in it, I think there was this conversation among the actors, the protagonists during brunch. Mm-hmm. I think they were talking about, oh, I'm rich, but I didn't finish college, right?
Mm-hmm. And then they shake hands and they're like, yeah, me neither. Yeah.
So there is also this kind of theme of downplaying a lot of values that have been very important among Asian Americans, right? Because education is a very important value for Asians in general. So usually parents would work hard and try their best to give their children the best education they could afford so their children could change their life and their socioeconomic status, right? And then in Bling Empire, we kind of see how this model minority image is also being challenged, right? But then again, think about the question I asked earlier, right? Affirming something and negating something, that still puts us on the dualistic spectrum, right? Because the underlying criteria has never been questioned. So is so that's that brings us to this question, right? I think in a different context we discussed image control, right? So image control is not necessarily a bad thing, right? Because image, it is neutral. And what matters is the context for interpretation, right? How we interpret the image. Right. So that's why Patricia Hill Collins, when she was talking about image control of African Americans, right, and members from the Black community, she mentioned that for a long time, right, African Americans, they have been portrayed in a very negative way. But there are also recently, right, there are also a lot of positive images if we think about Michelle Obama, right? So which means that those images presented or represented in popular culture, those images also give us an open possibility, right? Depending on how we want to interpret it, how we want to use it. So that is why I think this trend of rebranding the image of Asian Americans, it is very timely. It is also very urgent, but eventually it boils down to this question, right? What kind of representation do we really want? Do we want the representation of, so for sure, I think Asian Americans definitely share the consensus that the old image, right, of the, in French we say the booty bouffe chinois, like the little poor Chinese, that kind of image, right? That kind of image of Asian Americans being lesser, that is something Asian Americans, we don't want. But in the meantime, right, the model minority image, that also becomes problematic. Now the question in front of us is the image in Crazy Rich Asians and the Bling Empire, is that something we want?
Rebranding. If you see that image, the of Bling Empire, because you have this show Real Housewives, and this is kind of like the Beverly Hills equivalent white American woman of Bling Empire, also a reality show about very rich people spending money, basically. And I'm thinking, to what extent are you actually taking control of your image when you're staying in this dichotomy? And it seems like a reaction to like this controlling image that exists. And what you just said, to what extent is this a very constructive controlling image, or do you stay in the same conversation and is it just going back and forth?
I think it really has to do with,
There seems like there needs to be like a third, there is a third option, you know. there should be a way for Asian Americans to take control of their own image rather than a reaction to an image that's already existing.
I think here, right, probably something that's very crucial is that at least the production crew, right, needs to look at the image control really from an intersectional perspective, right? Earlier I think especially for Crazy Rich Asians and Bling Empire, right? A lot of Asians, they live in a very prestigious, they have a very prestigious social status because they, well, if we look at race and race only, yes, they are minorities, right? But if we look at socioeconomic status, when they are rich, are they still minorities? So I think something that could be very tricky here is, well, we want representations to promote diversity, right? So that's why there are representations of a lot of different cultural groups. But that is one type of diversity, right? Economic inequality, that's another type of inequality. So, but we don't see a lot of representation of people from an underprivileged socioeconomic status. So I think something that's quite crucial here is, it seems that the representation of Asians as rich and crazy, right? It also brings in a different type of stereotype of people who do, because if we think about Asian Americans, I'm pretty sure that not all of Asian Americans are rich, right? We are all seeing the not so rich, not so crazy Asians. Where are they on our social media, right? Like in our popular culture, they also don't have a voice. So does it mean that eventually it's just money talks? and then only people who are rich, they will have a voice, right?
I think what's very important in the idea of representation, or what I feel is a need often expressed, is for like a strong positive representation. For example, Disney princesses are always this idea, especially for children and for young adults. It's important to have idols, in a way, to create idols that have the same sort of perfection that is created in movies that feature mainly white protagonists. So that's like a strong need there. But is there a possibility that, in a way, Crazy Rich Asians, and maybe in a twisted way also Bling Empire, is like the first wave of breaking down barriers and especially contradicting these controlling mm-hmm. images, such as the model minority, or being super sexually promiscuous or hypersexualized or emasculated or in any way, and then afterwards can follow a more reflected, nuanced reflection of what it means to have an Asian American identity. Could you foresee, for example, that being a wave of filmmaking or pop culture production in the next 5 to 10 years?
I do not know whether that will be the future. That's the reason why I hope my fingers are crossed. Because eventually, right, as I mentioned earlier, rebranding is very important, right? Because mm-hmm. whenever we're talking about representation, we're actually talking about a very multi-dimensional initiative, right? Because mm-hmm. representation means both. We need to recognize that there are people who have a different lived reality, who have different worldview, who have a different value system, right? But then just recognize this is not enough, because as we said earlier, right, they don't have a voice. We know there are different cultures, but what the difference is like, right? So that's why there is representation also means to redistribute different kind of resources, right? If we think about rebranding, what is it? Isn't that also a redistribution of media resources, right? Mm-hmm. To people from a more marginalized position, for sure. But then this is the tricky part, right? When we start to think about representation as both recognition, like acknowledging diversity, right? And redistribution of resources. So what are the resources that are being redistributed? Is it just discursive resources, basically how we articulate ourselves? Is it just media resources? Mm-hmm. Or is it also about socioeconomic resources, right? So that's why earlier I mentioned that back in 2016, there were many different trends of rebranding Asian Americans. For instance, the other TV show I mentioned, right, Fresh of the Boat and Kim's Convenience. I have to confess that I am actually a huge fan of Kim's Convenience. Yeah. So the TV show is about a Canadian family in Toronto. And something that's very touching about Kim's Convenience is that it's just about everyday life of those Korean Canadians. They are not perfect. They have a lot of flaws, but you like them because they feel like real people. And then they have their own attitude, like Oma, the main character, that is also the matriarch of Kim's Convenience, that convenience store. She likes to do that sneak attack. And then she always tell her daughter that you should go and find yourself a lovely Korean Christian boyfriend. And her daughter is also very rebellious, right? Which you kind of see this generational tension between first generation immigrants and second generation immigrants. And her daughter is always like, Oma, that kind of crazy, Korean Christian boy, they don't exist. If they are Korean, they are not Christian. If they are Christian, they are not Korean. If they are Korean Christian, they don't like girls. But you look at it, you feel it's so relatable, right? It's fun. It's a fun to watch, even though it doesn't involve a lot of drama, right? Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, this TV show just ended. So okay. there are different ways to rebrand Asian Americans. So I do hope, as you said, Sophia, this will be a good start. But then eventually, right, something about TV shows, also why I chose this topic, also has to do with in communication study, there is this theory called the cultivation theory, meaning that whenever we are watching movies or even Disney cartoons, right, it's not that we watch it, we understand it, we enjoy it, but our worldview is also being cultivated by it. Yeah. So the idea is that basically what we have watched, right? So at the conscious level, we're fully aware about the message it is sending. But deep down at the subconscious level, our worldview is constantly being cultivated by different kind of messages we have received in our everyday life, in popular culture, in different places. And once those images has become sedimented in our subconsciousness, it will be very easy for us to internalize those images. That's why there are a lot of stereotypes, right? So if we think about the tragic event in Atlanta, right? Why the criminal, he decided to go to the massage spa to target at Asian woman, right? There is a reason. And who put that idea in his head, right? I'm pretty sure not anyone kind of standing out there and tell him, but there is this cultivation, this social cultivation that has been going on because of media representation. That's why similarly, right, for Disney cartoons, now all of us, we have grown up, we know, oh, that's just a fairy tale. But in the process of growing up, we are also being cultivated by the message, right, sent by those cartoons. Right. So that's why eventually media representation, right, they matter, not only because of the representation itself, but also because the social cultivation that comes together with it.
Yeah. And in that sense, I think Bling Empire is really effective in destructing the existing controlling images. It might at first be a bit like, okay, what are we looking at? But then if you, as it like so obviously targets at like this image of Asians being very perfect and the model minority, it is able, if you're watching this, it can actually destruct that. And then by doing that, it can make room for new images. And I think that's also what you were talking about before, Sophia, how it can make room for like new controlling images that are more constructive and more close to the
The question then remains though, is how do you do that without accidentally establishing a new forceful controlling image that equally becomes difficult to handle, right? So basically
one makes room for the other. And can we get rid of controlling images? I don't know.
Well, as far as I understand Patricia Hill Collins's article, controlling images do not necessarily have to be negative and are a substantial way of the part of the way that we navigate social life and being with each other, and they are relational in their nature. How do we transfer from one phase of controlling image healthy into, or like in a healthy manner, into a next phase of controlling image that might be a bit more developed and more nuanced?
I think there's also where distribution comes in, and like giving money, and like very literally, right? So really bringing money to the people that make shows that are more inclusive in that sense. I think it can be very a very pragmatic thing to actually make these controlling images.
So I think exactly as Cecile, you mentioned, I think as we said earlier, right, image control can be neutral. So it can be destructive, but it can also be constructive, right? I think one way for us to, I couldn't say we can absolutely make it constructive, right? But at least some effort we can make in order to make media representation of Asian Americans more constructive is to show the diversity, the differences inside Asian Americans, right? Like you said, so to be more inclusive, right? So we know the luxury life of crazy
We covered that part now.
So, Hollywood. But how about the lives of Asian Americans who come from a not so rich background, right?
Yeah. Do you know the movie The Farewell? I don't know what your opinion about it, but I feel like that could be a way of, in a nuanced mm-hmm. way, representing the way that an Asian American second generation or third generation young woman navigates, and not crazy rich, but totally normal, navigates her own life.
Right. I think, but we need more movies, yeah. right? Not yeah. just to Wong Farewell, but
the whole spectrum. because the Crazy Rich Asians, they're also there. So they're also part of the spectrum of the Asian American community. Yeah. And because they are there, apparently, and they do occupy a stage. And I think, this is maybe the first controlling image that's put out there. Yeah. Also because it taps into this, this kind of like Hollywood thing, right? This how do you say? Like this formula, if you will, of having a lot of like money.
Oh, it's fast food.
It's fast food.
It's, you know, it's one of those. One of those movies that are very fun to watch because they have a big stage budget. Already.
Yeah,
and they have great costumes and everything.
Yeah.
Right. So I think eventually, right? I think we always say that the devil hides in the details, right? Mm-hmm. So eventually, I think mm-hmm. what would be very dangerous is really to essentialize the image of Asian Americans again, right? To essentialize the image, overgeneralize them. As a matter of fact, when I was watching Bling Empire, I actually became very curious about the life story of each protagonist.
I've been Googling.
The layer of Crazily Rich, right? Remember, I think Kaylee, she mentioned that she was married to a very rich guy, and then afterwards her husband became bankrupted and then went to jail, so she started her own business. I think that was a great story, right? So about someone's life who was not financially independent, but afterwards she became financially independent and she is an entrepreneur. I think this story itself is very empowering, but somehow it was not being told, right? So it was just introduced as background information. And also for Anna Shea, her family story is a very interesting story if we look at Japanese diaspora not only in Japan, right, but also in North America. But interestingly, those stories about Asian Americans, they become entrepreneurs. What is the story of Asian diaspora, right? All of those stories, they are not being told. For me, I think those stories are interesting too, but this is a moment we kind of see that TV producers, they are selective in a certain way, right? But the question is, are they fully aware of the consequences here? So when they are being selective, are they also essentialize the image of Asian Americans again? And this kind of essentialization, right? Will it actually contribute to another type of, another form of stereotypes? So I think I very much agree with our conversation earlier that this rebranding is very needed. It has a very constructive role in it, right? Because it counters attack previous stereotypes. My concern or my worry is whether this kind of new rebranding will give rise to new stereotypes, specifically because this phenomenon of essentialization Asian Americans.
Well, but I mean, that is exactly, I think, the good thing, or I mean, we can always talk about like what does this new way of doing media, the streaming services, also social media as such, and content producing, and there are so many downsides, and I think that they're being talked about a lot, but I do think what also the medium of podcast, for example, is very positive is that it has this new way of expressing worry, of going along, being part of a new movement of knowledge production, because media production is knowledge production. I think we established that now. And it goes into the way that we see the world, and our worldview is influenced by it. So I think that maybe, and this is always a very optimistic part, but I try to be an optimist, is that by expressing these worries and by, as you said, the devil's in the detail, going over those movies after they're being produced and say, all right, how are we gonna create the next 10 years and the next 10 years of content production should watch out for these things and should bring more awareness to that and then that. And I think that that can be a big power and maybe actually change things.
Yeah, sure. I think on that front, I am probably more on board with Patricia Hill Collins than Michel Foucault. So I am also very optimistic, because eventually, right, when we look at popular culture or even technology, right, I don't think they are necessarily negative. Because eventually, right, they are being used by us humans and we have agency. So those new technologies, right, like podcast or streaming services like Netflix, I think they give us this open possibility depending on how we want to use it, right? The agency we're talking about. We can definitely use those new technology to reinforce a lot of stereotypes, but we can also use new technology to break barriers, right? It's just that every time when we try to push for something new, right, we are also entering the terrain of open possibilities again, right? Yeah. So we know what we shouldn't do because of our previous experience, but what we should do, right, that's a big open question mark there. So now we have this movement of rebranding Asian Americans together with movies like Crazy Rich Asians or the TV show Bling Empires. That's why now we have new questions, right? So I think eventually what we can do is to constantly reflect on the image that has been presented, and then that will give us a chance, right, to think about how we can do better.
Yeah, because also the viewer also has agency. You can also, like, the way you interpret things, we can, yeah, and I think that's really powerful indeed. And we just have to keep it dynamic and keep these images and stereotypes, reinvent them over and over again. And I think if you keep it moving, because there is no, I don't think we will reach a point where we just have all the perfect stereotypes. That's not unimaginable. So I do think we just have to reinvent it over and over again. And then I'm also quite optimistic.
Yay!
Yeah, that feels really good.
Yeah, no, but I do think that what comes clear in the controlling images is this thing. It's almost like, you know, you have a human factor that you can't get rid of.
Right.
And this image production or power structures as such, they will not disappear.
We need to grasp reality. Yeah.
But becoming aware of them and in a way cultivating yourself. I always think that's why our course was so great, because it brings together these ideas.
I agree.
In order to resolve a problem, we need to be able to recognize the problem first, right? So this kind of awareness. So think about our own experience, right? For instance, for me, I didn't even realize Asian American Americans were portrayed in such a negative angle until I started to be aware of those image controls, right? I am also a huge fan of Desperate Housewives. I think that was a very empowering TV show until at a certain point, I noticed that Asian Americans were not very much presented in that TV show. But I think there was this character, she was the assistant, the cleaner, for Gabby's family. And then I remember in that Gabby said something that you should just go back to your poor Shanghai. And then I was watching that, I was like, no, Shanghai was not like that. At that point, I realized, oh, this is what image control is about, depending on who is being portrayed and how that person is being portrayed, right? So I think having awareness of image control is actually the first step, right? And then we recognize the issue, and then we can think about how to resolve the issue and how to do better.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, well, I think because we wanted to not talk forever, I think we're already at 45 minutes almost. But I think this is a very optimistic note to end this in a way. very, you know, again, I think every time I go out of any class that discusses these things, it's not as such an optimism of being like, oh, everything's going to be great, but it's in a sense of grasping a bit more a way of, okay, there is a chance of turning this thing around in a way that might actually leave a lot of people with a good outcome. And of course, we're not going to resolve all inequalities overnight. And I think yesterday also, that's very, very difficult. But nonetheless, we can become aware of them and in that way structure our world maybe a bit differently.
The only small issue might be the redistribution of monetary value, but
okay, that might not
we can work on that too.
We can work on that next podcast.
Let's do that.
But overall, thank you so much for joining us today and having this it felt very short. I feel like we only talked for 10 minutes. But again, here we have podcast production. If you make it too long, then people won't listen to the end. And so, exactly. the attention span of listeners and viewers and audiences has become less. So we have to adapt to that too, in any shape or form. But it was really, really interesting, and I think for both of us also, I think it's important to mention our subjective position as white students approaching this topic of representation. It becomes an interesting conversation also from an intersectional perspective.
So let's just keep the conversation going, right? I think that's something we want, so we can explore different possibilities.
Definitely. All right. I think that is a good note.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much.
Both of you.